Hi everyone. So good to see you all, and hope all of you had a good Christmas and looking forward to a new year. I think Aaron and Steffi have already recapped what we were doing. I thought just like last few Sundays we have seen how Christmas is all about Jesus coming into this world and to reveal God's unconditional love. That's what we've seen. And also how God gives his peace in the midst of difficult circumstances, and how he gives joy that is unexplainable through our low times as well as our high times. So Jesus, while he was on this earth, did many miracles, like he opened the blind eyes, healed many sick people from different sicknesses like leprosy and sicknesses that had no hope and no doctor could cure. And also he made the lame start walking and many, many such things. In short, we can say Jesus, people who had no hope, he gave hope. And he even raised the dead, indicating that death is not really the end. So today, let us see a story about a woman. You know, when in our school, whenever I often see Meera saying, when she's narrating a story, she's always says, listen to the story carefully, I'll ask you questions. So like that, I also want to say that listen to it and I'll keep asking some questions. Okay, so this it goes like this. One day while Jesus was sitting and teaching a large crowd of people, some men came to him angrily, dragging a woman there. And they said, no, Jesus, we caught her doing a horrible thing of adultery, and we want to stone her to death. We want to stone her. So just let's pause there and think of what the woman must be feeling. I mean, which is true. She was really caught in adultery. So can you just unmute yourself and just give in some words, in one or two words, what her feelings must be, what she must be going through at that point when they dragged her and brought her to Jesus. You can either just quickly, some of us.
Shame.
Shame, yes.
Scared.
Scared, yeah. Right, I can see that this child, yeah.
This is the end of my life.
End of life, yeah. Yeah, so some of these things. So she was basically ashamed. She must have been, you know, ashamed that she was caught. And, you know, even could be regret of why she did that. And guilt. And so much of hurt. And everyone is watching. And a sense of hopelessness, right? So let's see now, the story continues. The response of Jesus is very different. He didn't say things like, oh, really? You caught her doing this? Well done, guys. You have a very high standard of morals. I'm impressed. No, he didn't say any of such things. Nothing like that, you know, he said, actually. He says, it's okay, it is true. He didn't say it's okay. It is true that whoever sins need to be stoned to death. But he says one thing, that any of you that have never sinned, throw the first stone. That's what he says. And now, can we just think of, you know, picturize this whole scene. Can you think of what these men must be thinking at that point when Jesus said that, okay, if one of you start, I agree with you, start, but do when whoever has not never sinned, throw the first stone. So what can we just unmute and quickly, what must be going through in these people's minds at that time?
They have done the right thing. They caught a culprit.
Okay.
All the sins that they have committed.
Yeah.
Yeah. Not me.
Yeah. Okay. So, as Shaina said, they, you know, their own sin must have surfaced. because Jesus, I mean, they couldn't hide, you know, they couldn't cheat to Jesus. So they must have felt a shame at the reminder of their own hypocrisy. And they must have cringed from inside, no? I mean, they must have felt like, oh no, now that we can't throw a stone and we have to leave, and so it is obvious that we have all sinned, right? That must be their feeling. So as we said, the men dropped the stones and walked away one by one until only Jesus and this woman were left. So now, why did Jesus say that? He knows that everyone has sinned, and the only one who had the right to stone that woman was Jesus, because he's the only one who never sinned. So Jesus says to this lady, this woman, where are the men who wanted to hurt you? She just looks around. She says, no, Lord, none of them are here. They've all gone. So then he tells her, then I won't condemn you. I won't throw a stone at you. But he says, don't go back and start living the same way. Stop living that kind of immoral life that you were living. So at that point, again, let's just think of what this woman must be feeling. What are the thoughts? What are her emotions at that point? Yeah, can some of you, other than who have answered?
Hope of a new beginning.
Hope of a new beginning. Yeah, right. Excellent.
Relieved.
Relief. Yes. Yes. Yeah. Correct. So she must have been so happy, so relieved, so thankful. She must have been overwhelmed, too good to believe that she's got another chance. And she must have just filled with a full of hope and a new beginning, as someone said, a new beginning in her life. So this is what God's heart is towards us, which Jesus came to communicate. Here Jesus came to give hope to a woman who had no hope in this situation. She got so entangled in a sinful life, and she had no control over her life. And she was stuck in a sin which must have become a lifestyle for her. So Jesus set her free. Actually, as per the law in those days, anybody who is caught in adultery had to be stoned to death. But by letting her go, it appears as though Jesus was breaking the law, as though Jesus was undermining her sin. But Jesus knew that when he dies on the cross, which was eventually going to happen, to take away the sins of the world, he was actually going to pay for even for this woman's sin. So he confidently tells her, sin no more. I will not condemn you. So Christmas reminds us that Jesus came to set all of us free. And on the cross, he paid for every sin of this world. Each of our sins has been paid for. And when we accept and when we receive what Jesus did on the cross, we get to live eternally with him in heaven after we die. Because why? The reason is God doesn't condemn us anymore for our sins, because Jesus has paid it all. And we also receive the power not to sin in this life. That's the hope Jesus gave this woman when he said, I will not condemn you and sin no more. On her own, she wouldn't have been able to do, but Jesus gives us the power to do that. Our lives are also, you know, broken lives. Or we can identify our lives with this woman, right? We might not be doing this kind of sin, but we know the sins we committed or the sins we still commit. And you know, some are secret sins, some close friends know. Vijay always says this. And then some only God knows. Because of that, we feel hopeless many times. We don't have to stay without hope. But the good news is that we don't have to pay for it. because of Christmas, God came as human to give us that hope that causes us to turn from our old ways to Him. Christmas is all about God breaking into a broken world, coming down as a human to help us to turn our hopelessness to hope. He came to forgive us and make us whole. Sin destroys us, so He came to really make us whole. Just imagine how this woman would have felt after knowing that Jesus forgives her, and that would have given her such joy and such freedom and such assured hope to live well. This is the grace that Jesus is extending to each one of us. Let's watch this video. One video I just want all of us to watch. Some of us would have watched, but you know, it never fails to just see the truth of it. Which this video depicts what Jesus has done to give us the freedom from some of our addictions, which entangle us and keep us tied down. Yeah, Vinny, can we see the video, please?
Cheers.
Yeah. So we have hope, you know, not only because we have forgiveness in Jesus, we have hope because God is working in our lives to get us better. He promises that he will remove our hearts of stone, meaning the hearts that are inclined to sin naturally, to do wrong things naturally. And he wants to do this exchange of giving us, removing that and giving us a heart of flesh. That's what the Bible says, which means a heart that is obedient to God. And this is the exchange that happened on the cross, as we saw in this video. This girl who, you know, was being battered by, you know, alcohol, drugs, vanity, suicidal thoughts, depression, love of money, you know, and we can add things to this, our own list, you know, each of us will have something. So all the struggles, you know, that we can think of. When we are in that kind of situation, like that girl is, you know, actually, there will be no joy. We will never be happy. You can see that this girl was wanting to get away from, but she was so entangled and couldn't set herself free from all those things. And Jesus knows that, and that all these things had to be removed by him to set us free. Only then we will be freed. And see how in the video, once he took all of it upon himself, the girl was so free and she was back in a relationship with God. And she was so happy doing what he is asking her to do. And we all can enjoy this freedom and such a lovely relationship with God, full of hope. And God specializes in taking these broken pieces of our lives and making a masterpiece out of these. As Annie shared, we all can experience that assured hope. You know, the hope that never fails, the hope that never disappoints, the hope that never puts us to shame. And that's the hope that God offers. What God offers is not some wishful thinking and not at all being optimistic. It is not just a, okay, consolation or not a perhaps, you know, maybe this will happen. Hope it will rain today, or hope I'll catch the train. But this hope that God offers is a sure hope of restoration, which we all long for in our heart, in our heart of hearts. Hope that God offers is not only that he forgives our sins, but also he leads us into the right path in this earth. He pulls us out of the hopeless situations that we ourselves get into. We've heard that actor Sushant Singh, how he ended his life. And we see many seemingly successful, fine people ending their lives like this because they couldn't cope with the hopelessness. This hope we have in Jesus helps us to be certain of God's goodness. Whatever may be the situation is God's forgiveness, God's sovereignty, and helps us to deal with whatever disappointment that comes across our way. Even when situations are visibly telling us just the opposite, there is an enemy who is always out to destroy God's purposes, and he is an enemy to God and to us. He's a liar and always tries to convince us by shifting our focus from God to the situations around us. Like, you know, God is not good. He is punishing you for your sin. He doesn't love you. These are some things that, you know, the lies of the enemy. He doesn't care. There is no way out for you. Things will never change. You are like this because of your own karma. And all that is utter rubbish. Whatever you are going through right now, God is offering you this new life with a new heart where he will be your Lord. When we put our trust in Jesus, he gives us faith to encounter difficult situations with a new hope, knowing that God is in control and he is good. Hope for eternal life after death. life, to live now on the earth, to live, you know, victoriously over sin. Life of hope, that all hopeless situations, whether it is a corona time or it is a depression or it is a financial struggle or some marital problems, relationship issues, name it, you know, sickness, you know, we can add into this or anything. None of these are hopeless situations when we put our trust in Christ. So I want to end this, you know, with this promise that Jesus promises a life of abundance that is filled with hope. You know, the John 10:10, it says, the thief comes only to steal, kill, and destroy. I came that they may have life and life in abundance. So this life in abundance is full of hope.